to those who are in a particular perversion. Well, God loves sinners. That is what the gospel is all about. God loves sinners. Our text from 1 Corinthians hits one of the hot buttons in our nation today, homosexuality. Some people, even within the church, are becoming rather confused about this issue. We've got churches here in North Dakota who are splitting over this issue of homosexuality. Some people, in an effort to try to, you know, to logically think through this issue, really begin to grapple with questions like, well, maybe people are born with certain tendencies. Maybe a person's born with masculine traits or born with feminine traits. So like, how could God possibly hold them accountable? How could God hold them accountable if their behaviors are coming out of their genetic makeup? Remember, sin has infiltrated the human race like a disease. We are all sinners, and God will hold each of us accountable. I think sin has even affected our genetics. I think some people are born with a propensity to be a liar. I think some people are born towards a bent toward being a thief. I think some people are born with a predisposition toward alcoholism. I think that some are born with a weakness toward infidelity and unfaithfulness. Yet sin is sin, and God holds each one of us accountable. Those practicing sin will not enter the kingdom of God. Let me read it to you again. Our text, 1 Corinthians 6, 9 and 10. Don't you realize that those who do wrong will not inherit the kingdom of God? Don't fool yourselves. Those who indulge in sexual sin or who worship idols or commit adultery or are male prostitutes or practice homosexuality or are thieves or greedy people or drunkards or are abusive or cheat people, none of these will inherit the kingdom of God. My heart goes out to ones who are struggling with various sins. Sin has infiltrated all of us. But our God is so powerful that he can even change feelings and desires. He doesn't want his children eating out of a pig's trough when they could be eating at the king's table. To someone involved in a sinful practice, whatever it might be, I say this boldly and unashamedly: God has something better for you. God has something better for you if only you will trust him enough to receive it. If you are involved in a type of sin, God does not hate you. He loves you. He wants the best for you. If, you know, I showed you a picture of my two boys. And if my youngest, who just turned 3 on the 29th of November, if I took him into a public restroom and I'm busy washing my hands or whatever, and all of a sudden I see him go over to a toilet and like scoop out some water and begin drinking it, what would my reaction be? Well, I would be horrified. I'd be like, no. And I would probably use words like gross, yucky, ishy, like just anything to communicate that no, 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 we do not do this. Would I hate him? Of course not. Of course not. But I want to give him something better. I want to give him clean water to drink. Does God hate us who are caught in sin's trap? Of course not. He loves us. He loves us so much that Jesus went to the cross for us. But he wants something better for us. Some of us here might be tempted to say in our hearts with a passage like this, you know, from 1 Corinthians, well, I would never do some of the things that are talked about in that passage. You know, that's for the like really bad ones. That no, I would never do something like that. But let me remind you of what Jesus had to say on the Sermon on the Mount. In Matthew 5, verses 27 and 28, Jesus says this: "You heard that it was said, 'You shall not commit adultery.' But I tell you that anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart." Jesus has just leveled the playing field. He's pretty much nailed every man who's ever walked planet Earth to the wall. Guilty of sin. Sexual sin is not just present in overt sexual acts. Sexual sin can be a look of the eye. It can be a lustful thought of the heart. Pornography is huge in our world today. It has been estimated that the pornography industry in the United States generates $10 to $14 billion a year. You can wrap your mind around that. $10 to $14 billion a year. The enemy of our souls is trying to steal away from a whole generation the beauty and the intimacy of sexual delight within marriage. The enemy is trying to get a whole generation addicted to pictures in a magazine, images on a computer screen, images on a smartphone. These are addictions that can destroy marriages. These are addictions that can keep young men slaves for the rest of their lives. Recent data indicates that many women are now getting very involved in pornography. Many of the soap operas that have been streaming into our homes for years now, I think we should really call them what they are. What is a soap opera? Pretty much pornography for women. Filled with romance, affairs, lust, deceit, betrayal, and much more. There is a monster lurking within each of us. And the enemy is coming to steal, kill, and destroy. The enemy is even using tools like Facebook and MySpace to start online affairs and destroy marriages. The monster must be dealt with. But what can be done? Well, there is one, and only one. There is one who has taken on the monster and won. We started this message by reading those passages about the virgin birth. Why is that significant? Why is that so significant that Jesus had to be born of the virgin? There's one clear reason. If Jesus had entered this world through the normal process that you and I had entered this world, he too would have been tainted with sin. But Jesus enters the scene as the sinless one. And every time Jesus goes up against sin, he overcomes. Every single time. Jesus' victory over sin did not come easy, though. He came into the world sinless through a virgin birth, through an act of a holy God placing this baby within Mary's womb. But his battle with sin was not just like, you know, just he didn't have to do anything. No, he battled this out. If we read in Hebrews 4:15, we read this: "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin." Hebrews 5:7-10. "During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and with tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, and was designated by God to be a high priest in the order of Melchizedek. Jesus went to the cross as the sinless Lamb of God, completely without sin. Do you realize what happened when Jesus went to the cross? He went to the cross because of the monster within you and I. He did not go to the cross because of the monster within himself. He went to the monster that was, he went to the cross because of the monster that was within us. And to read you just some passages that indicate this, listen to 2 Corinthians 5:21. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Romans 5, 6 through 8. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Colossians 2, 13 through 15. When you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He took it away, nailing it to the cross, and having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Jesus took your sin and defeated it at the cross. You know, we talked about how you and I were born into sin. We were born into sin. But do you realize from Scripture that we can be born again? In John 3, 5 through 8, Jesus is talking to Nicodemus, and let's pick it up at verse 5. Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." Jesus has defeated sin, and anyone who comes to him for salvation is born again. And sin's power in their life is broken. The monster no longer has rightful ownership over their lives. But here's the big question. Here's the big question of this. Can a person sin after they've been born again? After that stronghold has been broken, after they've had a fresh start, a new beginning, can we sin? Well, I think from Scripture and from personal experience, the answer is a clear yes. Yes,